we're going to welcome an old comrade of Janine Vegas, Ed Sanders.
For Janine Vega. She was soaked in a literary life from the age of 16 in 1958 when she met the Beats in New York City and then lived with Peter Orlovsky and Allen Ginsberg and Herbert Hunke and was a friend of John Wiener's. She had a nonstop life of poetry, travel, mountain climbing, journal keeping, and interactions with poets and writers. She helped found the first poetry reading series here in Woodstock in 1969 with the late and missed George Montgomery and Carol Berger. She lived in Paris, in Israel, in San Francisco, in Ireland, and other places. In spite of her seething searches, she also found solace in home in 1979 when, with $5,000 she inherited from her mother, she purchased a house in Willow, which was a winning beacon, an unwobbling pivot from which she traveled the world, conducting her winning workshops with prison writers and met up with poets and writers virtually all over the world. Reading through her books and manuscripts, it comes home how much she exulted in climbing the high places of the world. She had a restlessness that spilled her out upon the mountains of the earth. And to describe in journals with her poetic eye intact many countries, north and south, far east and to the west. She climbed all the peaks of the Catskills and exulted in it. And she also climbed up the high glaciers of Peru and the mountains of Nepal. Searching. But she had also found a home in between her searches. Here's a brief poem written in Nepal, in September of 1988. Homesick, so she's homesick for, I guess, Woodstock, on a glacier up in Nepal. Why am I crying? Heap the hills up, one on another, and infinitely capable, I scale them every one. And so what? Where do I go? Surrounded by village blend of voices, cries, and laughter, I close the door. As high as they live, and precariously as they walk, they are a nestling tribal people. Heights only if inhabited, where they go. And me, also. In recent years, she had to give up her climbs up mountains as she struggled against her afflictions, so stunningly revealed by Andy Clausen just a minute ago. As she struggled against her afflictions while keeping her constant smile and goodwill. Ah, Janine. We miss your life at the microphone, the hike, the journal, the house, and the struggle to forge a more sharing and friendly world in the long, long journey.
Well, when Ed mentioned that Janine started the first poetry series with George Montgomery, reminded me suddenly of the time my first meeting with Janine. I was invited to read a year or two after that as part of that series. And here I am out of New Paltz. I'm just a 21-year-old punk and didn't know anybody in Woodstock, and it was at the Espresso. And I got up and I'm reading my poetry and absolutely nobody is paying attention. Everybody's talking and carrying on at the bar, but Janine is sitting right in front. And I knew who she was. And I read one poem and then she said, "Wow, man. "That was a great poem. Do you mind if I read it?" And I said, "Sure." And I handed it to her, and I thought she just wanted to, you know, just look at it on the page. She gets up on the stage and she yells, "Shut the fuck up!" Pin drop silence. She reads my poem, she gets applause, she hands it back to me, I start reading again, everybody starts talking. That was my meeting with Janine. So, Janice King, now of Walla Walla, Washington, was one of Janine's great friends and poet buddies in Woodstock. She can't be here, but she sent us a poem. And Carol Zaloom, who did the illustration on the cover of Janine's last book, The Green Piano, is going to read it.
Well, it's an honor to try and channel Janice from Washington. She told me that after she found out about Janine's death, she went for a long walk in the hills. It's not on?
Buzz it through it or bring it down a bit.
Oh, sorry. Better?
Better.
No?
Yes.
Okay. Anyway, when Janice found out, she took a long walk through the hills of Washington, and as she was climbing, she looked up in a tree and saw an owl high up in the tree, and she told me, as soon as I saw the owl, I just said, "Hey, Janine, it's you." So this is for Janine, love from Janice. "These woods appear just before sleep. It is very late or very early. A humid breeze is redolent with basil, rosemary, and wild roses. Deer circle the garden, moving in deep shadows along the slope. The east is not yet pink in the pre-dawn of this new journey. Before you is justice, an unimaginable wilderness. Lover's eyes are new again. He is whispering bright words you have never heard. Flickers play paradiddles on the old oak. You are strong and climbing. Your radiant laugh is answered by a flock of owl-eyed familiars. Their hoots and jingling red bracelets traverse the stars to a dark cloud constellation of Sonoha, Cusco's tambourine. The hills are singing, the arching foot of a jonquil at attention. In your heart, you offer a white chrysanthemum. This time, the flies are drunk on a glacier, talking to you." Mm. And Janice says the lines of the final stanza belong to Janine. So probably you knew that.
When I first got to Woodstock, and Janine was letting me know like what her favorite kind of music was and this, and I was showing her what I had been into, and one time she played a tape of Tom Pacheco and the Hellhounds, and I said, "That doesn't sound too bad," and she said, one time she said, "We're going to Rosendale. I bought you a ticket. We're going to Rosendale to listen to this guy, Tom Pacheco." I says, "I don't know. I don't feel like a..." "Come." I says, "Okay." And when I went, the first song, I said, "Wow, this guy's a good songwriter." And second, I said, "Hey, that's two in a row." And then by the third song, when he started sweating, I said, "This man is his..." Something else he believes in all the words that he sings. Ladies and gentlemen, one of America's great singer-songwriters and one of Janine's favorites, Tom Pacheco.
You know, I first met Janine Vega formally in 1979 at a place in Mount Tremper called the Whitewater Depot. Some of you might remember that. But I had lived for about 13 years in Greenwich Village. I had an apartment on McDougal Street for 13 years, and I would see her, but hadn't met her. I once saw her walking down McDougal Street with Allen Ginsberg, and
and Gregory Corso. And that was a weird combination, because those two were always feuding at that time. And she became a close friend over all of the years that I knew her. She was could be ferocious, she could be tender, she had incredible political convictions, and she really believed in what she believed. This song is for her, because our first conversation was about the Tupac Amaru, a revolutionary group in Peru in the late 70s, early 80s. And she'd been down there, I believe. And then we talked about Cuba, and it went on and on and on. She always was a close friend. This is for her, it's called Che. Rosario, Argentina. He was a young doctor by trade. Restless eyes, romantic heart, blue blood in his veins. How could anyone know back then, as a tango dancer swayed, he'd be the most wanted man in the world, with a star on his beret. He went off to the jungle with a friend for a holiday. That's when he saw a homeless leper sleeping in the rain. The poverty and misery, so many destitute, whose souls were ground into the dirt by the foreign corporate boot. And a fire consumed his spirit, like a sinner born again. I guess you can't really blame him if he got a little crazy at the end.